Today we are going to have a limited time lecture because there is a workshop running upstairs, but also it is one of the interesting and leading edge topic in geophysics. This one is called seismic attributes, and specifically we are going to speak about amplitude versus offset method. So, as a statement, AVO is a change in amplitude versus angle of incidence of the seismic waves encountering the geologic boundary across which rock properties change. Okay? So, when the angle of incidence of the seismic ray, which means when the offset change, the amplitude also change. Such a change is related to the physical properties of the two material or the two layers in contact. The principal component of seismic waves are P wave and S waves. Particle motion from P wave is parallel, of course it's a longitudinal one, while S is perpendicular. So P wave, as we said before, is dependent on the bulk modulus or modulus of incompressibility, whereas the shear wave depends on the modulus of rigidity. The components of the rock, which are the minerals, the fluids, and the framework, contribute to the overall compressibility and rigidity of the rock and directly influence both P and S waves. So any material, any sedimentary material, is composed of a number of constituents. The material itself, the lithology itself, which is defined by the matrix, and the porosity, and what and most important, what's filling this porosity? This pores is either filled with fluid like water, like oil, like gas, or maybe filled with air. There is nothing inside. So the presence of these cases, of these fluids, together with the lithology itself, plays an important role in the type or in the mode of a change of amplitude of P and S waves with the offset or with the angle of incidence. I guess we remember this figure. Now we have the incident B wave. This incident B wave is reflected as S wave, and here with reflection coefficient RPS, and reflected also as P wave with reflection coefficient RPP. And these are the one that we are interested in, reflection method. And also two refracted energy, also transmitted S wave and the transmitted P wave. So we have energy partition, the energy carried in the incident ray is now subdivided or distributed over four types of waves, of rays, two reflected and two refracted. So if we assume that we distribute evenly, so we have 0.5 for the S, 0.5 for the B, 0.5 for the transmitted S, and 0.5 for the, 0.25 for each of them. However, such a distribution is dependent on the angle of incident theta. So the angle of incident theta plays an important role, and the change in the RPS and RPP is dependent on both the lithology and the fluid content. So basically what we are looking for is to invert or to have an idea using the pre-stack data, okay, to try to have an idea about the lithology and the fluid content. You know, generally speaking, that we know lithology from wells, and also we have idea about the fluid content from the well logs. At certain place, we drill well. We have, you know, mud logger. This mud logger is examining the fragments of rocks coming to the surface, and say now we are in identified. Now we are in sandstone. Now we are in shale, and so on. So this is the definition of the lithology itself. It takes samples and cores also taken and analyzed at the laboratory. When the drilling is off, we start by putting certain instruments for well logging, for example, sonic, for gamma ray, for many kinds of logs. We use this to identify the porosity, permeability, the fluid content, and so on. So what we try to do with the AVO is to have the ability from the seismic to obtain such parameter without the need for further drilling. Because as you know, we can have a good idea about the subsurface using wells. However, we cannot drill many wells because the well drilling costs a lot of money. And suppose if I drill wells for interval of say 100 meter, I will also miss important information in the 100 meter interval. If I am making at 50 meter interval, there is 50 meter interval may contain valuable information. So I will pay much money and yet I will get incomplete picture. So, or incomplete image. So, we are trying in AVO to imitate well logs using analysis of seismic data to obtain information about both the lithology and fluid content in the subsurface. So, the start for this was Aki and Richards. They said that plane wave reflection and the transformation coefficient as a function of incident angle and the elastic properties of the media. Yes, they said that the plane wave reflection and transmission, I think this statement is not meaningful. Okay. Aki and Richard identified, maybe we remove set, identified that plane wave reflection and the transformation coefficient is a function of incident angle and elastic properties of the media. Do you know plane wave and cylindrical and spherical wave? Plane wave is an approximation to the actual one, which is maybe we can say spherical wave. So at certain extent, we can regard the wavefront as plane. So we call plane waves, and the rays are straight line, and the rays are also parallel. So the statement or the start of this is taken from Aki and Richards, And Ack and Richards in the 80s postulated that the plane wave reflection and transmission is a function of angle of incidence and also is a function of the elastic parameters. And we are interested in two main parameters, the modulus of compressibility, and this modulus of compressibility depends on the volume of the matrix and the volume of the pores. So when you have high porous material, so it's more compressible than one with low pores. So the modulus of compressibility for porous material will be less than the modulus of incompressibility, will be less than that of the non-porous material. And also depends on the rigidity, and as we know, rigidity means the resistance to change in shape. And if you have fluid, and this fluid actually has zero rigidity, so the net rigidity of the rock will also reduce. AVO is done in order to determine the variation in P wave, the velocity of P wave, and S shear wave velocity, and also the density of the medium. It means that changes in seismic amplitudes with offset are due to contrast in the physical rock properties. So if we agree on that, so change in amplitude reflect a change in physical properties, so we are going to model the relation between the change of amplitude with the contrast of physical properties to have an idea on to determine these physical properties. That's what model mean. I think you are lost. I don't feel you are following me. I am right or wrong? You are lost.
No, I'm following.
You are following. Who is not following? So all of you are following? Excuse me?
Sketch.
Sketch? So, lend me we don't have, unfortunately, we don't have we have a lot of markers. Okay, I'll try here. So very easily can say that AVO, the change in amplitude with offset, is proportional to the physical parameters. Okay? So if we can find the relation here, which mean the model, we can say that AVO equals something physical times physical parameters. So if you can define this constant or this relation, knowing the AVO which we are observing from the seismic section, we can apply to this model to get the physical parameters. Simple examples are like Ohm law, you know Ohm's law. We have two parameters. Okay, we have potential, we have volts, electric potential and electric current. We have these two parameters. They are related to to each other. As we increase the volt, okay, current increase, right or wrong? Voltage increase, current increase, right or wrong?
Yes.
Okay. So, what is the relation relating voltage or potential and current intensity? The resistance. So, Ohm postulated his law, and now the model parameter here is the resistance. So, if I have the potential, say 220 volts, and I have the resistance, I can just to go in the model, V equal I times R. So suppose I know the voltage and I know the resistivity, the resistance, I can deduce or estimate the current. Okay? So this is what we are going to show or to see, that from the mode of variation of the amplitude versus offset, and relating such a change with the contrast in physical parameters, we are going to find some relation. This relation, this model, will be used to identify the situation in the subsurface, to try to determine the lithology, and also to determine the fluid content. This will be obvious by the end of this lecture. So in driving, we first put the relation between the parameters we have. We have the parameters in terms of free wave velocity and shear wave velocity, and also the density. So Castagna provided the relationship between P wave velocity and shear wave velocity in this form, and then Gardner derived relation between the density and the B wave velocity. Okay, so this will be used for determining the relation, the final relation. Then we have Zipret's equation. This equation is used to determine the reflection coefficient for the incident P wave and reflected P wave, and we designated here by RPP, and also the reflection coefficient for incident P wave reflected as shear wave or S wave, RPS, as a function of angle of incidence theta. Okay, so we have these two relations. We have constants like B and C, AD and F, HB square, and here we have also A, B, C, D, and V, P, and D. So this question, this constants will be minimized, simplified in the forthcoming slides to provide the final model that relates this one. The first attempt to simplify is the linearization made by Shuey. He rewrote the approximation which has been introduced by Aki and Richards in this form, where RPP of theta equal A, this is a constant to be determined, plus B sine theta square, plus C sine theta square tan theta square. But sometimes, because this term is very small, sometimes in literature the last term is neglected, and we have only the linear part of the model. Thompson, another one, yes? Is there any question, any comment? Okay. Thompson, another one, approximate also the RPP. In his approximation, he used various computations to describe the magnitude and the type of rock. His approximation has become the most effective way to compute the partitioning, the portioning of seismic energy, which portion will be reflected B, which portion will be reflected S, and which portion will be reflected, refracted B, and also S. So for one of his equations, the PP reflection coefficient is given by this relation. From this relation, you can determine the values of A and B. So for Shoei's, after removing the last term, we end up with the relation between R, where R is a reflection coefficient for PP, and the angle of incidence. We have two parameters to identify. We have A and B, where A is the intercept amplitude, which is the amplitude at zero angle, which means amplitude at the zero offset. And also B is the gradient, and this, all these approximations are done for distances below, for angle below 30 degree. Angle of incidence below 30 degree. So they term this analysis as nearest stack analysis. So Shoei approximated the equation to the form like the one that we have seen before. R of, it's turn it here to pi, it's theta, equal A plus B sine square theta, where A is the intercept and B is the gradient. And here we have the values for A and B. A, here it's 0.5 equal 0.5 times delta VP divided by VB plus delta rho divided by rho. And the gradient is, this means we have other other terminology. It's not related to Europe as a continent. Equal 0.5 delta VP divided by V minus 2 VS divided by V all squared times 2 delta VS divided by VS, which means we are estimating or normalizing the difference in shear wave velocity, and the difference in intensity, and also the difference in P wave velocity.
Okay, what is P?
I just said, and you seem not following me. I said this is only different in terminology. Another terminology, another equation. Okay. So we end up having four classes: class one and two. Class two, we have 2P and ordinary one, and class C and class four. So the one we are interested in, is class three. In this class, we have strong negative impedance, and this strong negative impedance, as you see here, result in the amplitude increase in both directions, and this cause what is termed as bright spot. And this bright spot is related to the presence of gas, because gas gives negative impedance, and this negative gives low impedance, and this low impedance, when compared to the above and the lower media, it will be negative because the up above and the lower become higher in impedance. So we'll have negative impedance. Then we have a change with amplitude, high in amplitude in the reverse direction. That can be justified here. So in our analysis, we are interested, we have sandstone, and we have shale from above and shale from below. And of course, sandstone is assumed to be the reservoir, so we want to know whether this sand contains oil or gas or not. So this is the basic usage of AVO. So here we have, in class one, we have increase in impedance. It starts with high amplitude and reduced with offset. Class two, we have impedance difference is minimal. It starts with low amplitude and increase with offset. Here in class three, impedance decrease start with high amplitude and increase further with offset. See, compare between this and this. Here increase in impedance, here increase, but here the amplitude reduce, but here the amplitude increase. Class four, impedance decrease start with high amplitude and decrease with offset. So as you see, this one related to the class three, this one represent the shape of Pratt's spot. I will show you an example in the coming slide from a research paper we made in 2012 to show you this point. So this is the example. This is placed in the offshore in Egypt. This area is characterized by the presence of huge gas potentials in the Mediterranean. Here we have three wells, well number one and number two and number three. Two of these wells produce gas, whereas the third is not producing. And the objective of the research paper, it was actually a master thesis, is to try to answer why this happened. I'm not going to go forward, but I will give you this. The part that we are interested in, which is the AVO result we have. So this is a map of the subsurface. We have these are gas chimneys. You know gas chimneys. What is gas chimneys? The Mediterranean at certain geologic time was closed sea, and the water of the sea totally evaporated, and the thick bed of saline of salt is deposited, and then afterward it's accidentally opened again, and then it was filled again with water, and newly sediments were deposited. So this section is very soft. Down in the deep, there is oil. This oil try to escape to the surface. So what's going on is that it makes like chimneys up to the surface. You know what chimney means? So it's like I am having like I'm having soft layers, and then the gas here want to escape upward, find the weakest point, so he make way for him, for his for its passage to the surface. So it makes chimneys. Okay, so we have here, as you see, three chimneys, and now we have the wells. Well number two, the reservoir is 25 meters sand, and the net bay is 3 million. Well number three, the sand is 13 meter, but and the net bay is 3 million, whereas well number one, in the same age, in the same bed sand also, 25 meter sand, but the net bay is 0 meter. So this slide and the following one represent how the amplitude change with the incident angle. So this is arbitrary. Arbitrary means that actually we don't have profiles. We have cube. Okay, we have 3D data. So in softwares like Betrel, you can choose a profile, certain profile, and produce it as this one. So this is the output of Betrel. So this is the data for arbitrary seismic line, not true seismic line, because this is 3D data, through the wells in near stack volume. I hope you memorize how the amplitudes look like to compare with the far stack volume. As you see, the amplitude changed greatly from the near stack to far stack. That's what we mean by the change of amplitude versus offset. So the change in offset produced a change in the amplitude itself. Then applying the AVO, we determined that for well number, for the wells, here is a well, and you see here, this is a bright spot, that's why. And here is the one. That's why we have producing oil here. Because actually, at this point, at this well, the well comes in a place with gas accumulation. The situation for the solution or the answer to the problem is that the presence of this fault here, it's in yellow. I don't know whether you can see it or not. There is a fault here. Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry it wasn't good enough, I think. But I will also tomorrow give you more illustration about AVO. Okay, so you have any comment or any question for this for today's lecture? Yes, Mohammed. Excuse me. Yes. In what condition C will be neglected? Yeah. Okay, now sine theta. Now theta between 0 degree and 30 degree. Okay? Sine theta is a fraction. Okay? And tan theta also is a fraction. And both these fractions are raised to power of 2. So, and then both those fractions are multiplied with each other. So the contribution from the third term becomes so small that it can be neglected. Excuse me? Yes, because if you at sine 30 it's equal half, and tan theta is 1 divided, I guess, 1 divided by square root 2, I guess, or I'm not sure, but maybe it's 1 divided by square root 2. But when you arrive at 45 degree, sine theta increase, and tan theta become 1. And if you move further, tan theta increase. And until 90 degree, it becomes infinity. So this neglection or neglecting this term in the window for the incident angles. Not for all angles. Yes? Okay. Kazim? Satisfied? Okay. Inshallah, tomorrow I will bring you more examples about AVO and I will review some of the points with you. Okay? And please, as tomorrow would be our last lecture, so if you have any comments, any problem, you can we can agree or set a protocol for accept or receiving comments from you and answering you. I will try to find out why the forum is not working. Why you are not able to post? Maybe you need to do something from your account, because it seems that you are subscribed to the forum. I don't know why you cannot reply or join the forum. We'll see and try to find the problem. Okay.